About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host. Unfortunately, both of my guests for this evening canceled out at the last minute. So I quickly looked through my archives and I found a program from December of 04. So I certainly hope you enjoy the program. Can we run the tape? Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host. I hope all of you had a very nice Thanksgiving. It is so hard to believe that it's almost Christmas. But since it is December, we decided to bring you some toys for Christmas. So our guests are Diane Ondo, and she has an Affenpinscher, which is this funny little scruffy black thing here, and Jan Doherty, and she brought her Papillon. Now, you saw Papillon in the intro that's running across the dog walk. Well, that's a Papillon. We have one for you here this evening, so you'll be able to hear all about the Papillons as well. So I welcome both of you ladies, and I think we'll talk to Diane first with her little Affenpinscher here. The Affenpinscher is the black one. The black one, right. Got to get the right dog here on the screen. It's this funny little black thing that's panting like crazy. Diane, suppose you tell us what an Affenpinscher is. What does even the name mean? It's such an odd name.
It is. This was basically relatively, I would say, a breed that was not very popular for the longest time because kind of nobody knew what they were.
Uh-huh.
But this is a very, very, very old breed. We're going back to the 17th century in Germany. This little dog was used in the stables to keen out the mice.
Oh,
they
ratter.
Weren't ratters, they were micers.
Mousers.
Yes, mousers.
Wow.
They would keep the mice out of the stalls and the horses. And this little dog was then taken to Belgium, and that's where they created the Brussels Griffon.
Oh, okay, because, so they look very much alike.
They look very much alike. Mm-hmm. But this dog is basically, can be other colors. You've got them almost like a black and tan, or what they call a grizzle, which is sort of a brownish color.
Okay.
And they can even be a little bit more wheaten, but I think the most popular color is the solid black.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
About that. So then this was a German dog, and then Pinscher means dog in German.
Yep, and Affen means mustache, so this was the mustache little devil, or some people like to say monkey-like. It has to have that monkey expression, which the little pushed-in mouth and nose, and that's why the little dog is panting, because they don't do too well with a lot of heat.
Yeah, well, especially with the pushed-in nose.
Nose,
you know,
right.
They snorkel to begin with, and then with the heat, they snorkel even more. The coat is so odd.
It is. Well, it is a hard coat. It's a terrier-like coat.
Oh, okay.
That can be hand-stripped and trimmed a little bit. So this dog was definitely very weather-resistant.
Okay. Yeah, because when you hand-strip them with the terrier coat, of course, it
keeps
very
it hard.
The water just runs right off of them.
Right.
Now, you were saying hand-stripping. Mm-hmm. What do you mean by hand-stripping?
Well, basically what we would do is we would pull out the longer, fluffier hair on this dog literally with your hands.
Oh, you
like
pull out.
Like you do a terrier.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then, well, you use sort of a tool, too, don't you?
Yeah, you can use a stripping knife.
Okay, Are they usually, if this were a pet dog in a pet home, would they just have it clippered like at the groomer, or would
you
they
can.
Just let it
you
go?
Can. No, you
how
can
long,
clipper it.
How long does it get if you don't hand strip it? Is that the length of the coat?
No, it'll get longer, and it'll eventually start clumping and probably fall out.
Oh,
it'll
okay.
start dying and falling out on
okay.
It doesn't actually shed like a regular shedding dog.
Okay.
But if
okay.
you don't do anything to this coat, like comb and brush her, she will start losing her hair.
All righty. Okay. As far as temperament, she seems like such a sweet little thing.
They can be. They're very, I'd say, one owner oriented, though.
Oh.
This isn't exactly an ideal family dog.
Okay.
She's definitely my dog. She has no leash or collar on. She would not think of leaving me, but she would not go to strangers.
No. Okay.
This dog's definitely one owner.
Terribly devoted to you.
To one. Yep.
Wow. Mm-hmm. That's interesting. So even in a family situation, it would still pick out the one that it liked.
Mm-hmm.
How popular are these guys now?
They're probably more popular. When I bought her, and she's 10, there were maybe only 50 in the United States.
Wow.
Now we've probably got, you know, maybe 1,000, 2,000. They're a little bit more popular, but basically more or less in the show ring rather than in pet homes.
Yeah. I would say even, you know, for 1,000 dogs, when you're talking about, like, Labradors and Goldens,
right,
which are registering 40 and 50,000 dogs a year,
this
1,000 is
still
not
a very popular, because it isn't an ideal, like I said, family dog.
Yeah,
you know?
But you'd think with the size, it would be so much more popular with people like in apartments or the elderly.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Those are the ones. The only thing is, this is a very busy dog.
Oh,
Gertie
okay.
doesn't sit still long. She is now because she's older. But as a younger dog, she was very busy. I mean, they get under your feet. They're with you. And a lot of people don't like that constant in-your-face movement. She's... very like watching what's going on every couple minutes. She's not one to just lay there and look like a prima donna.
Well, then that wouldn't be good for an older person, because if they got under the, you know, you'd be falling and
right. This is an
homeless
active little dog. Yeah. She's very active.
What about health problems? Do they have?
Well, you have the slipping patellas, which is the back of the leg,
the knee
socket comes out. Other than that, this dog has been very, very healthy. The nose is not a problem unless, you know, like I said, you don't take care of it. We keep her in the heat or the, you know, too much
summer. Well, yeah, I guess she would probably have heat stroke.
But she's definitely been very, very healthy. The only thing she has now is a couple cataracts.
Okay.
Other than that, you know.
Yeah, because it looks like she has all her teeth, too, which is what a lot of small dogs lose.
They
end up toothless.
Right.
Like us.
No, she's very good when it comes to that. She's had a very good, healthy diet, and she gets a lot of exercise, so she's definitely keeps herself in shape.
Good, very good. Are they easy to train?
Yes, she's very easy to train. She wouldn't think of doing anything anywhere. As far as housebreaking, you tell her what to do, and she was very good with that.
Oh, well, that's good. That's good. Because a lot of the smaller, especially the toy dogs, have... I guess maybe it's their routine is not on our routine or something. It's so much harder to catch them. I was talking to a person today who said that, you know, her dog is so hard to housebreak. 6 months old, and it's a toy dog, and she can't get it housebroken. And I suggested using a litter box, which she hadn't even thought of. She said, I just can't catch her when she's going to the bathroom. You know, she's already gone, and she doesn't even know she's doing it. It's even hard with larger dogs, but it seems it takes them longer.
Some toy breeds.
Yeah, yeah.
No, this dog was very easy to housebreak. She's very good in the house, except, like I said, she follows you everywhere. She's always under your foot. You can never leave her alone. Or she doesn't leave you alone.
So then she really makes her own exercise. They're
yes,
not difficult
yes.
to
no,
exercise,
no, no,
right?
No, 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 no.
What about a fenced yard?
She goes out and runs around the fenced yard and
but
and plays.
Would she need a fenced yard, or would this be a breed that you really wouldn't, you know, if you were a single person in a home but you didn't have a fenced yard, would you need to worry about
this? I don't know. This dog especially, I don't know about the rest of them, but this one would never leave my side.
Okay.
So she doesn't need a fenced yard.
Okay.
Now, if you have, it depends, I guess, on how you raise them. I got her about 6 months old, and within the week, she wouldn't leave my side.
Wow.
She was attached to me, which was amazing.
Not even for a mouse?
No, no. She doesn't even bark at the squirrels anymore.
Oh, she used to bark at squirrels?
She would. She's definitely alert barker. She will tell you somebody's in the house or somebody's coming around.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
They're not quiet. She can bark.
It's just that she's very quiet.
She's really quiet.
She has a curly tongue.
Yes, she does. They have a very long tongue for their mouth.
Do you think maybe it's the tongue is the right size, but they pushed in the nose?
Yes,
so that now the tongue doesn't fit in.
Right, it doesn't fit in anymore.
Well, she does. She can fit her tongue in her mouth,
though. Yeah, she can. But that's one of the faults of the breed. If they shut their mouth because they are undershot and the tongue does appear, then you can't show them. They don't want the tongue to stick out when she does shut her mouth.
Okay.
So they do have a long tongue, and the fault can be that the tongue is sticking out.
Huh, how about that? Interesting. But she has very dark eyes, but I just see this little tongue, you know,
it's
waving back and forth.
She can put it in.
So when you do show her, Does the judge actually touch the mouth?
Yeah, they want to see that she's undershot. Other than that, they wouldn't care.
Oh, mm-hmm. Okay. No. Okay. Do you want to put her up on the table so we can see her a little bit better, since she's sort of blending in with your dark sweater?
You don't.
Oh, of course, now she's blend. Now, wait a minute. Let me move over a little
she's
bit
She's
going
to blend into you, Patty.
There we go.
There you go.
I'm wearing red, so now you can see her a little bit better. There
she goes.
Stand her up here.
Can you stand her up? See if she'll stand. She probably don't want to stand
She's
no
not
more.
Going to stand on the table.
No, it's slippery.
Yeah, you poor thing. But she's such a cute little thing. What does she weigh?
Oh,
maybe
geez.
About 8 pounds?
Yeah, not much more. Between 5 and 8 pounds for the standard.
Yeah.
They changed the standard now because, as you see, she has what they would call crop ears, and she has a dock tail. Most of the Affin pinchers you see now will have floppy ears, and they'll have a long pointed tail.
Oh.
So they'll look a lot different than her.
Why did they decide to do that?
I have no idea.
Well, I know in England they're not doing the
They're
tail.
Not
okay.
doing that docking and cropping.
Right.
So
well, actually, in all of European
This breed, things. The standard says either way, but what they're doing is taking the side of letting the hair, the tail and the ears natural, so you're seeing more.
Okay.
This is probably the last you'll see of the cropped and docked Affin pinchers.
Huh. Interesting. Mm-hmm. I think she would look cute with ears.
Yeah, I don't think you'd mind, because you want to have that, you know, expression with the hair around her head.
Little, right, that goofy little scraggly look.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't look like a tidy dog.
No, no, they're supposed to look scruffy.
Scraggly,
right. They're supposed to look like a monkey.
And it makes you laugh.
Yes,
it really does make you laugh. What would you change about this breed?
I wouldn't make her so possessive.
Okay, all right.
You know, a little bit less possessive. Other than that, they're really fun little dogs.
Yeah.
If they weren't so possessive and so active.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Does she get along well with other dogs?
Yeah, she can.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yep. She has no problem with dogs, cats.
Because I know you had other dogs.
Yes, I have other dogs. She lived with. She spent a couple weeks with my daughter, who has cats, and she had no problem getting along with cats.
Oh, she's probably smaller than they were.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So she respected them.
Yeah. Wow. Why did you select this breed?
I was looking for a toy dog, and somebody had suggested this because of the grooming, similar to my terriers.
Uh-huh.
And the opportunity just came along that there was this puppy who was out of a group winner at the... Mm-hmm. Westminster Kennel Club. Her father won the breed there a couple times.
Wow.
And I said, hey, give me, I'll take her. We'll see what she's like. And 10 years later, she's still with me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think once they arrive at your house, they stay
forever
anyway.
They do.
So, you know,
it was a fun, she's a fun dog. Yeah.
Well, she does sort of look like your Cairns,
mm-hmm.
too.
She does. She's very much like mm-hmm. the terriers, mm-hmm. very much terrier-like.
Yeah.
So she fit in very well.
Very good. Okay, we'll give her back to you, and then we'll talk to Jan. And Jan has a Papillon. Now, that's a very strange name, isn't it, a Papillon? What does Papillon mean? Obviously French.
Papillon is the French word for butterfly.
Oh, what's she catching, bugs?
I don't
Wait, my buggy studio here, the dog just caught one.
Unfortunately, your ears don't seem to show up against
against
my
your dark color.
Very well, but if you could see the edges of the ears, you would see that they do resemble the wings of a butterfly.
Oh, okay.
When they're in the show ring, they're standing down at your feet, you're talking to them, and they literally move their ears. And they look like the
like
flutter
butterfly
of a
wings.
Butterfly.
Yeah, okay. When she's alert, she brings them forward.
Yes.
Wow, how about that? So it's a little butterfly dog.
That's exactly
it. It looks very much like a butterfly, doesn't it?
And a lot of the Papillons have a white blaze that goes up the center of the forehead. That's the body of the butterfly, so it adds even more to the illusion.
Okay, how about that? Now, this is a French breed, right?
No.
Oh,
it is not.
All right,
it has a French name.
It has a
French name. It originated in the Far East, became popular in Belgium.
Okay.
Has been in existence since about the 1400s.
Oh, my word.
Is pictured in many of the old artists' pictures.
Okay, the Flemish, like the tapestries. Yeah.
The Flemish artists especially show them.
They,
on the continent, were known as dwarf spaniels.
Okay.
Their ears, in that case, were down rather than erect. And that version also carries through to this day in the United States, and those are known as Phalenes. So there are two versions of the Papillon that can be in the show ring.
But it's only the ear set that's different?
That's the only difference.
Huh. How about that? Because the Norwich and the Norfolk are two entirely separate breeds now, and the only difference I can see is the ear set, too, but, you know.
The standard is identical with the exception of the set of the ear.
How about that? Wow. That's interesting. So, we have a French dog and an English dog that's German and a French dog that's not, that's Belgian, or Near East, or Far East. How popular is this breed?
This breed was very rare when we first got into it, which has been 38 years ago now. It's been a long time. It has gained drastically in popularity since their win at Westminster about 6 years ago with John Olton and the wonderful Kirby.
Yes, yes, I do seem to remember that. Right. Wow, how about that? Why were they bred? Just as carry-arounds, or were they?
They were lap dogs. Yes, okay. They were court dogs to Marie Antoinette. It's not been proven, but long been a story told about Papillons that they followed Marie Antoinette to the guillotine under her skirt.
Oh, okay. Gee, I thought that was the Bichon. Wrong breed. Oh well. What is the temperament on these guys? She seems so,
they're wonderful.
So sweet and happy and loving life. And
as a breed, they're very happy. They're very alert. They are extremely intelligent. But they're very friendly to strangers. They don't know strangers.
Oh, okay. Wonderful.
A little bit unusual. They do not have a toy dog temperament, or what is thought to be a toy dog temperament.
Uh-huh.
They really are more sporting dog temperament.
Well, maybe that's a spaniel that was in there.
Yeah.
Do you have any idea what was, have they ever gone into what actually was put together to make this breed?
They're known as the only true toy.
Huh.
They are not a combination of any two breeds. They are their own breed.
Huh. That's interesting, because you'd think that it would something, you know, like with the Pekingese. You know, the Pekingese have been forever, and that's behind everything, almost. The Pekingese, obviously, it's behind these guys. Anything with a pushed-in nose is Pekingese. So, wow. What about grooming?
Grooming?
She has a double coat.
No, she does not.
Okay.
Papillons have a silky coat. They have no undercoat.
Okay.
They will shed drastically, I might add, about twice a year. In between, normal brushing should keep the loose hair down.
Okay.
They will, when they are freshly bathed, have loose hair, and I'm wearing it at the moment.
And you don't wear dark clothes if you have a light-colored dog. Do they come in other colors?
Papillons are any allowable color except liver. They are always predominantly white.
Okay.
They can be black spots on the white. They are a party color dog.
Okay.
The head and ears must be colored. Must be colored from the forehead back. They cannot have white on their ears, or that's a disqualification.
Huh.
That's considered to be a mismark. The color can be black with tan, can be any shade of red, which we call sable for the most part.
Wow, okay. Well, I guess that would sort of, if they had white on the ears, it would sort of destroy the butterfly effect anyway, because it would grab your eye. You know, the white part would grab your eye right away, being white.
But being a party color dog, that probably creates more pets than anything else, to have a puppy born with a white rim along the ear, or a white tip.
Okay.
That's something that's immediately identifiable.
Yeah. Would it matter if she had white around the face?
Color must cover the eye rims.
Oh, okay. So she'd definitely have to have a color, at least a mask type of thing.
Yes.
Wow, that's very interesting. What about health problems with these guys?
As toys, they're very substantial. They're a hardy breed. They don't have a lot of inherent problems. As with the Affenpinscher, they can, in certain lines, suffer from patella luxation, which is a slipping rear kneecap.
Right, right.
We don't like to see it happen.
Mm-hmm.
Reputable breeders will always try to eliminate that fault from their lines.
Right.
For the most part, I think our greatest health problems have been related to loss of teeth.
Okay.
That type situation.
Okay, toy dog, no teeth.
They live a long time.
Hey, you said what, you have a 17-year-old?
I have a 17-year-old now. My other, another dog that I had was 18 and a half when he finally passed away.
Wow, that's really, would this dog
it's be... not at all unusual for them to be 16.
Jeez. Would this dog be good for an older person in an apartment? Are they alert dogs as well?
They are very alert. They're very responsive to their situations. They are very easily trained, so that's helpful to older people. They're good at notifying older people when the mailman comes, when the telephone rings, when something is occurring that person should be aware of.
Oh, okay.
They learn that very easily. A lot of Papillons have been trained to be assistance dogs, even though they're not large like the Shepherds.
Yeah.
But they can jump up easily into your lap.
Sure.
Let you know something's going on.
Right. And they probably would be good, too, with, like, fetching keys or socks or, you know, something small like that that an older person would have difficulty reaching down to get anyway.
Right.
Right. Wow. Okay. Exercise requirements? They make their own exercise inside as well?
Exactly.
Okay. Underfoot or not underfoot?
No. As puppies, they seem to learn to avoid your feet very quickly.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Again, that probably goes back to the great intelligence that they have in all areas of life.
You see a lot of these dogs in agility. I don't see that many in obedience. I know there are a lot in obedience, but not in this area. They're not very popular in this area. Right?
That's okay.
But you're not going to see, you're not going to see these dogs walk, either one of them, you're not going to see them walking down the street. Because they're not
as prevalent as a lot of toy breeds, but it's surprising how much more I see than I would have 10 years ago.
Oh, okay, mm-hmm. Okay. Because they're both, you know, they're such sweet dogs, and you would think these would be ideal companions for older people, but they just, or even...
They're good family dogs as well. They're great with kids.
Oh, are they?
Yes.
Wow, wonderful.
A lot of toy breeders do not like their animals in a situation where there are young children, but if the family has taught their children to treat animals correctly, I have no problem placing a pup in a family home because they're just great with kids.
Wow. Well, with the energy level, would be just the right energy level for a child, you know, to race around the house and have a good time with. I mean, this is it. Both of them are even dogs that little girls could dress up in, you know, outfits and make them look so cute. And, you know, that's what little girls like to do, dress up their little toy dogs. Are they hard to housebreak?
I don't find them to be hard, but we use a couple tricks with ours.
Okay.
Especially on the males, and I would emphasize to anyone who's considering a Papillon, please consider a male.
Oh.
They are the sweeter temperament disposition of the two sexes.
Yeah.
With a male puppy, I advise that you use a man's tube sock. You fold it, put it around the puppy's middle, pin it. It's a soft material. It stretches easily. It absorbs any liquid when the puppy starts to do what it shouldn't be doing at that moment. It also eliminates any scent that puppy goes back to mark at a later time.
Oh, okay.
Gives you some time to grab the puppy
and race
slip it off the rear and get it outside. Yes.
How about that? Oh, I could see me doing that to my dog.
It's very good in a motel room when you're traveling to shows with males with strange smells and everything.
For marking,
else.
Sure.
We always take a tube sock in our supplies.
Yeah. And I would think that they probably, because it is restricting, they probably would not be as prone to lift their leg because they feel this, you know, restriction around the belly.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to agree with you. I think the males are sweeter too. I think in every breed, I think most of us would, unless you're thinking of possibly breeding the dog, I think definitely the males are the sweeter of the two. But then, you know, what does the male have to do? You know, not very much. The girls are the one who have to raise the litter, and they have to be more independent because they have to know what they're doing. And the boy dogs are, you know, just hello there. So, wow. Bad traits. Things that you'd like to change about this breed.
They bark.
Oh, okay. Not a good apartment dog.
They bark when a leaf falls.
Uh-oh. So they really alert you.
Cece's being very good right now. She's not being noisy.
Very
but
good.
There are moments when she can be.
Oh, how bad. And you would never think to look at her that they would be barky dogs. They just don't look like that type of dog.
Dogs that have been in a show environment, I think, respond better to different situations.
Yeah.
A family pet who does not have that outlet will bark more, I'm sure.
Oh, okay. Okay, so it's not another dog that you'd like in an apartment. Why did you select this breed?
I didn't.
Oh, okay.
I'm a second-generation breeder. My parents saw their first Papillon in Phoenix, Arizona, when I was... Well, as I said, it's been 38 years, so I won't say how old.
When you were young.
When I was much younger.
When you were a little girl.
Fell in love with the breed, had an elderly toy Manchester at home, would not get a puppy to take in on that old dog. While they were out of town on a trip, the old dog became sick, died shortly after they got home, and at that time we got our first Papillon.
Oh.
So... they actually started the Trace Lynn kennel name, and
you've
I
kept
joined
it up.
Them. Yes.
Wow, how about that? So obviously you must like the breed.
For 38 years, I have
you
not
have to
been
like the breed. Since that's the only breed you have. You don't even have any other breed, do you?
No.
No, Diane has two or three breeds, but you only have
it's
the Paps.
Strictly Papillons.
Wow, that's wonderful. Well, I guess that's all we have for this evening. When we're talking about toy dogs, you only have very small litters. People say, oh, why do they get so much money for toy dogs? Well, you have a lot of problems breeding with toy dogs. So approximately how much for an Affenpinscher if somebody wanted to buy one?
You'd probably be looking at $1,200 to $1,500.
$1,200 to $1,500. And the Paps?
If you're talking a pet quality dog, about the same amount.
About
a show dog
mm-hmm.
would be much more.
Okay, mm-hmm. okay. So if you're interested in a small breed, it's going to be a little more expensive than your big breeds. The reason you need to go to a breeder rather than answer an ad in the newspaper is so you know the dog is healthy. Even though these dogs don't have major problems like some of the larger breeds, like with the hip dysplasia and you know, eye problems, although I think the Paps, do they get PRA?
They can.
Okay.
The Papillon breeders have been in the forefront of...
Testing.
Right. We were one of the beta testers
for
the breed, and we publish the name of any dog that is shown to be a carrier or affected, and that dog is not used for breeding.
Okay. So that's one reason why you should be going to a breeder, so you know that your dog is healthy, and you definitely do not want to get a puppy for Christmas. It is not the best time to get a puppy. There's too much going on. There's trees, there's tinsel, there's light bulbs, you know, on the Christmas tree. That is not the best time to get a puppy. I know it looks very Norman Rockwell, but think twice because your family is extremely busy at that time of the year. So definitely wait until after Christmas, or if you have to have a puppy in your household at Christmas, look for one now. So that you already have the dog in your home, he's used to you, used to the goings-on before Christmas even arrives. Otherwise, springtime is a wonderful time because then you don't have to go out in the middle of the night in the snow. So that's our show for this evening, and hope all of you have a very nice holiday. And for tonight, good night.